Thank you. So in line with that, I should mention that actually, practically since I went to graduate school as a social psychologist, I've been interested in computational modeling of social behavior and social reasoning, which made me a fairly unusual social psychologist. And I should mention one other thing is most of the computational modeling I do these days is based on neural network models. And I actually really got into neural network models because I ran into a conference once at Ziva Kunda, and she said, you really should look at this new paper by Paul Thagard on the echo model that's in Brain and Behavioral Sciences. And I read it and said, can I be a commentator on this paper? So you're responsible for this talk, Paul. Okay. So anyway, so what I'm going to be talking about, and this actually does tie into a long thread I've had in the interest in the nature of personality. And so I'm going to be talking about this neurobiologically inspired neural network model of motivation and personality. A lot of the ideas throughout the years have been worked on a lot with my wife, Lynn Miller. And then over the years, been worked on with a number of students, Vita Drutman, Ben Smith, Ken Lam, Brian Monroe, Aaron Brownstein, Yu Young, who's responsible for the Chinese idioms, and Gravine Chopra. Okay, so what I'm going to do today is I'm going to talk about the application of a neural network model of personality that we've developed. But the general idea and the general thing I'm interested in is modeling the following things, which are actually all tied together. I'm interested in modeling motivational dynamics, the structure and dynamics of human personality, and everyday decision making, and I want to tie them all together in terms of understanding organized motivational systems. And this is based both in research from personality psychology and also more recently, I've been drawing much more on work on the neurobiological bases of motivated behavior. This actually began life as an attempt to build a model of human personality, but it's become broader than that. So today, I'm going to address two questions with this model. Both of these are questions actually the personality psychologists are really interested in, but I think a lot of you might be interested in them as well. So personality psychologists have established that there are broad, stable, between individual differences in behavior, and we call that personality. But as I'm going to talk about, personality psychologists have done a less good job of telling us what are the underlying mechanisms for personality. At the same time, there's a lot of work on stable individual differences between people, but one of the things that really has started to puzzle personality psychologists is at the same time that you have these stable between individual differences, you have considerable variability within people. So, for example, you will find that the variability within a single individual and how extroverted they behave across their week is just as big as the variability between people. So what I'm going to do today is talk about, well, how do you get both out of the same system? How do you get stable between individual differences and at the same time get this very large amount of variability across time and situation? So obviously people differ in their behavior. Some people are highly sociable, like to be with a lot of other people. Other people sort of like to stay in their room and study. Some people like to be the leader of a group. Other people are perfectly willing to be followers. Some people are conscientious and disciplined. Other people are lazy. So we all know that, and that's something that we're all aware of in thinking about other people. And what personality psychologists have called the big five personality factors helps us organize or structure that behavioral variability. And if you're not familiar with the big five, I'll go through it a little bit. So basically the idea is that if you ask people to respond to a number of trait scales or you have people rated by people who know them well, and you then take those ratings and factor analyze them, again and again you get this structure that has been called the big five, or it's also been called OCEAN as an acronym to help you remember what the big five are. And the idea is then once you have people on these big five dimensions, you can then basically take them and rank order people relative to other people, and you end up with a profile. And this is arguably one of the great achievements of personality psychology. They basically, again and again, they find this structure of personality. But there's a problem, which I'll get to in a minute. But just for anybody who's not familiar with sort of the Big Five, I mean, everybody will recognize them. You just may not know them as the Big Five. But so the acronym is OCEAN, just because openness to experience. This is originality, open-mindedness, originally and complexity. Conscientiousness, this is constraint, control, socially prescribed impulse control. Extroversion, everybody's familiar with that. Energy, enthusiasm, energetic approach to the social and material world. Agreeableness, which is getting along with other people, altruism, affection. Neuroticism, negative emotionality, nervousness, negative emotional responses to events. Okay. So those are the Big Five. So we have this Big Five structure. It's been replicated again and again. But why do we have this behavioral structure? What gives us this behavioral structure? And this is a big question in personality psychologists. There's been a lot of discussion over the years, but there's not a lot of consensus on where this Big Five structure comes from. And what we want to argue, Lynn and I and our students want to argue, is that basically what leads to this Big Five personality structure is underlying motivational structures or motivational systems. So we argue that basically there are the motivational systems are organized so that there are essentially five major systems that underlie behavior, which are then organized into two higher level approach and avoidance systems. I should mention that with the Big Five, actually, there is a higher level two-factor structure which corresponds to approach and avoidance. Okay, so we want to argue that, you know, these motivational structures are responsible for the behavioral structures. And the question is how, though? I mean, it's easy to say that, but how can you do that? So the first simulation I'm going to talk about basically is a demonstration of how you can go from these what these underlying motivational systems might look like and how that could give you this Big Five structure. So over the years, we've been working on this neural network model of personality, and we argue that you can understand personality as arising from the interaction between structured motivational systems, but equally important is the nature of the situations that people are in. Okay, so it's not just let's look at the person and what are their motivations, but what are the goals of the situations they find themselves in. So, and we argue that there are these structured motivational systems, so that you, and when I structured, I mean there are these specific brain systems that manage a variety of different motivational domains like mating, parenting, friendship formation. And then there are these high-level approach and avoidance systems dealing with reward and punishment that sort of integrate over these lower-level systems. And the other part is that situations, when you move into a situation, situations activate motives that can be achieved in that situation. So in today's talk, I'm going to try to do three things. One, first, I'm going to try to show, or not try, I'm going to show that these structured motivational systems can take variability in chronic motivations across individuals and give you something from which you can recover the Big Five. But I'm also going to show that then that despite this stable between-person structure, that there's considerable within individual variability and that this system and this kind of model is also going to allow you to understand the dynamics and change over time in behavior so that we can sort of show how personality variability is going to arise from the interaction between people's motives, the affordances of the situations they find themselves in, and their current bodily state. And finally, I hope I'll be able to talk about how this model maps onto current knowledge about the brain bases of motivated decision making. This model started largely out of the personality literature, but we increasingly are looking at the overlap between this and what's known about motivated decision making in neuroscience. Okay. So theoretical background, let me give a little theoretical background for the model. So as I've already alluded to, there's a structure of behavior that needs to be explained. And for those who aren't familiar with it, the structure actually has been revealed in two different ways. So first, actually, Alport and Odbert and other folks said, let's look at the language that people use to describe other people. Let's look at personality language. And they got like 15,000 words, and various people after that factor analyzed those words. And you get something that looks very much like the big five that I showed you. Separately, people took personality scales that have been developed over the years and also factor analyzed those and said, you know what, we get the same kind of big five structure here. We get the big five or ocean, which I already talked about. Okay, whoops. But why this structure? What would give us this structure? And I'm going to talk about a couple of different sources of this structure, and then I'm going to provide a simulation. So the theoretical background, there are multiple sources of theoretical background. First, for a long time before we ever got into this modeling, Lynn and I had been arguing that you can think of personality traits in terms of configurations of chronic goals that people have, plans and resources that people have, and beliefs and styles. And the idea is that when you use traits to describe people, you're basically saying that these things are true about people. And if you think about this, particularly we're going to be talking about goals, if you say that somebody is sociable, you're saying they want to be with people, they find it rewarding, they like to help people, they want to hurt or punish people, they want to dominate or lead, they want to run away from possibly a dangerous situation with both anxiety and fear of rejection. So the idea is that underlying all traits pretty much are these different kinds of goals. In addition, there's a lot of work actually from a lot of different sources that suggests that there are two broad motivational systems that practically any organism has. So Larry actually mentioned the fruit fly, and at one point, not the fruit fly, but the fly, and he was mentioning separate punishment and reward systems. And this is sort of central in human beings as well. So Gray and other people have talked about the approach or the behavioral approach system. It's basically governs sensitivity to cues, signaling reward. And you also have an avoidance system, or what's also been called the behavioral inhibition system, which is argued to underlie neuroticism, which is one of the big five. So you have these two broad motivational systems in practically any organism. In addition, underlying each of those sort of broad motivational systems are more specific motives. So for instance, within approach, you have things that we're trying to achieve, like finding a mate, nurture young, affiliating and bonding with peers and forming friendships, dominating or leading. We avoid things like we want to avoid physical harm, we want to avoid social rejection, we want to avoid punishment. And there are also, I'm not going to really talk about this, but there are also work obviously on various neural systems having to do with reward, self-regulation, and increasingly interest in sort of the role of interoceptive systems. So in today's talk, I'm going to examine these complex motivational dynamics. I'm going to show how the structure of personality can arise from these underlying motivational systems. And so basically, I'm actually going to, in the first part, I'm actually going to provide a simulation in which I basically simulate several hundred individuals or several hundred neural networks and show that if you factor analyze their behavior, you can get something like the big five. I'm then going to show how a similar network with a similar structure can actually capture motivational dynamics over time and large amounts of within individual variability. And then, as I said, I'm going to talk about the underlying neuroscience if I get a chance. Okay, so I know for a lot of you this is not going to be new, but I just sort of want to basically point out the structure of the computational model. So basically in this computational model, we have nodes that correspond to individual features. So we have nodes here that represent situational features. These might represent different bodily states. And we have nodes that represent different goals and different behaviors. Okay, and the level of activation represents their importance and their readiness to fire and send activation to other nodes. These nodes are organized in layers. So we have situational features, which are sort of features of the environment, bodily or interoceptive states, individual, here's an approach system and the avoidance system. And in addition, I think most people know this, but then we also have hidden layers. And the hidden layers are basically responsible for creating higher order representations from simpler lower level features. And then finally, we have the links between them, the connections between nodes, which represent the strength and direction of influence between the different nodes. And these sort of roughly correspond to synapses and neural systems. So in this particular model, the way processing works is information about the situation in the bodily state is sent to approach and avoidance motives. These individual motives are activated as a result of interactions with this changing situations. And one of the ways in which we capture personality, actually I'll get to that in a second, but so the nodes are, the activation of the nodes is partially due to the current situation, the feedback you get from the situation, your current bodily state. And then individual, one of the ways that we capture individual differences in the model is you can set baseline activations for the nodes in the approach and avoidance layer. And you can also manipulate the gains or sensitivities of the approach and avoidance layers, both of which are going to affect the likelihood that those nodes are going to fire. And then the activated motors send activations to behaviors and that can help to satisfy these motors. Okay, and as I mentioned, you can capture individual differences in terms of sensitivities of units in the layers, both the individual layers and the gains on the overall layer. Those are two sources of individual difference in the network. Another thing that's important in this particular model and this particular architecture is that you have inhibition and competition within the layers. I mean, that's one reason in this particular architecture to arrange it in terms of layers, so that what happens is goals, you know, multiple goals can be activated, but they'll compete for activation. Same thing, multiple behaviors may be activated by the situation and the goals, but only some behaviors can be activated. Okay. For anybody who's interested, this is modeled in Emergent, which is done by Randy O'Reilly at UC Boulder. And it uses what he calls the LIBRA architecture, which stands for Local, Error-Driven, and Associative, Biologically Realistic Algorithm. And it also, obviously, it also has learning in the network as well, obviously. There are a couple of important parameters in the model. I already mentioned this. Gains that for approach and avoidance layers, so you can change the sensitivity to inputs and the baseline activation of individual motives. For anybody who's interested, this is sort of in some ways it's a standard neural network model. It's just basically the current activation is equal to the previous activation of the node plus the new activation that comes in. One of the things that's relevant to LIBRA is the change in activation is a function of the current excitatory input level and the gain or conductances for the excitatory input channel. And this is actually a parameter that you can use to manipulate the sensitivity of nodes or the gain of nodes. And it's a way you can sort of capture individual differences. And output activation is, again, fairly standard. You basically take the activations represented by the X's times the weights, and then sum, and that gives you basically the excitatory inputs, and the output function in LIBRA is just a linear S-shaped function. It's a fairly complicated function, so I'm not going to go into any detail about it. And then obviously it's a standard learning, standard network, so you can have learning, both Hebbian or correlational learning, which is basically sensitive to just do two nodes fire at the same time, and then error-correcting learning, which is basically you adjust the weights from the input to the target based on any kind of prediction error. And LIBRA actually will combine those two kinds of learning. It also has inhibition within the layers, which I mentioned, which you can manipulate by a combination of feed-forward and feedback inhibition. And you can use this to capture, in addition just to do things like choice among behaviors, you can use it to also capture things like attentional focus. Okay, so that's probably a, so that's sort of the theoretical background. And now what I want to do is I want to talk about one of the simulations, and particularly how do you simulate the Big Five. So the idea then is if personality traits and specifically the Big Five arise from the interaction between organized motivational systems and the goal affordances of situations, then if we model several hundred individuals and then vary the parameters of their underlying motivational systems, so like how sensitive are they to approach stimuli, how sensitive are they to avoidance stimuli, what's the baseline importance of different motives, and if you modify that systematically across a large number of different individual networks, and if you then take that behavior from all those different networks, you should then and factor analyze it, you should be able to get something that looks like the Big Five. Okay, so this is sort of a theoretical model or a theoretical network, but the idea is that what you can do is you can have situations, this is sort of a schematic, but situations activate individual motives under extroversion, openness to experience, agreeableness, conscientiousness, and neuroticism. And then each of those motives is tied to multiple behaviors. So, and then the idea of the system is that the situations activate motives, and then the activation of the motives activates linked behaviors. But it happens to be the case that multiple behaviors are relevant to achieving each particular motive. So the idea is that if multiple behaviors are relevant to achieving each particular motive, then potentially the activation of a particular motive may activate a set of possible behaviors, and then you're going to have to choose among them. But the idea is that because each of those sets of behaviors depend on a common motive, that's going to tend to build in correlations among the activations of the behaviors. And the particular, the one simulation I'm going to do draws on this one particular version of the Big Five that divides the Big Five just into what he calls approach plasticity and avoidance stability. I'm mainly pointing that out just in case anybody wonders why I have two nodes in the approach system and three nodes in the avoidance system. And you can ask me more about the model if you're interested. So basically, we're going to have five different underlying factors with five different corresponding sets of motives. And so this is actually what the simulation, this is a screenshot from Libra. And you have 30 different situations, each represented by a localist feature. You have a hidden layer. You have the approach and the avoidance layer with five motives, two approach, three avoidance. And then in this, I set the individual differences in motivation baseline activation just by using a secondary layer that just sort of inputs activation to set the baseline. And then I have 30 behaviors, and this is wired up so that six behaviors are tied into each of the five motives. And then the way I wired them up basically is that each of the situational features co-occurs equally often with each of the motives. Now, this is not realistic, but I was just looking at, for this particular simulation, I'm looking at the impact of motivation. And then each of the five motives is trained to be equally linked to each behavior in a cluster of six behaviors. So basically what happens is, over time, you develop clusters of behaviors that are tied to a particular motive. And so what'll happen is, you know, on average, when you activate a motive, you're going to tend to activate the associated behaviors. And to do this, I generated 766 individuals with different patterns of individual differences. And what I basically did is I mentioned that I can manipulate the gains or sensitivities to the approach and avoidance layers, and I chose three different layers, three different levels for each of them, which gives me nine combinations of sensitivities for the approach and the avoidance layers, all combinations of input to the motivation layer that sets baseline activation, which gives me 2 to the fifth, 32 combinations, which gives me 288 unique individuals. I could obviously get a lot more if I wanted to vary the parameters more. I train two different random networks with different random starting weights, and that gives me 576 unique individuals. I then tested the individuals by basically just taking 5 passes through those situations so that I have 150 total test situations. So basically what I've done is for each of those 576 individuals, I have their behavior for each of 150 situations. And then I record the net activation across the 30 behavior nodes, which you can actually, another way to think about it is you can think of the behavior nodes as basically 30 items on a test. And if you then factor analyze those activations across, you know, so you basically treat it as having 576 individuals with scores on 30 items, and then you factor analyze it. So factor analysis, for people who aren't familiar with it, is basically a way of taking a matrix of correlations and reducing it to an underlying set of dimensions or factors that will sort of still capture the maximum amount of information. Essentially, factor analysis, you're basically extracting the eigenvectors from a matrix that basically are sort of a collapsed representation. And as you can see, you end up with five. This is a scree plot, and this basically what a scree plot does is it tells you when there's a sudden change in the amount of variance that's accounted for by a dimension. Okay. So this basically says there's this systematic, and then it basically it just flattens out. So once you have five factors, you really don't account for any more variance. And if you do a factor analysis and then look at the factor loadings, you basically find that you get this too nice, but maybe really nice sort of factor structure where you get these six behaviors that load highly on extroversion but nothing else. And with except for this one minor glitch, you get a very nice clean factor structure, which basically says you have these five relatively independent factors with this sort of underlying five underlying dimensions. So what this is saying is that if you take a system that's structured the way we structured the neural network, and then simulate the behavior of a lot of different individuals, you can get something like the Big Five. This obviously doesn't prove that this is where the Big Five comes from, but it's sort of an existence proof that basically says this is one way you could get something like the Big Five structure in terms of these underlying motivational systems. For those of you who are familiar with sort of latent variable analysis or structural equation modeling, you could think of this as sort of similar to like a latent variable situation in which you have an underlying latent variable that's causes the responses on a number of indicators, in this case, behaviors. Okay, so then what we're saying now is, well, what are the mechanisms for structure? And how can the occurrence of consistent and stable behavioral patterns be explained? And consistent with what I said at the beginning of the talk, we're arguing that you can explain them in terms of these underlying motivational structures, and we've shown with a computer simulation how these underlying motivational structures could give you something like the Big Five. So we have this evidence of here's one possible way in which you can get these stable individual differences. But as I mentioned, another problem that personality psychologists have been concerned about, and maybe other people have been concerned about as well, is great, you have this stable personality structure, but if you actually look at people's behavior, so for example, Will Fleeson and a couple of other people have done what are called experience sampling or EMA, ecological momentary assessment studies, in which they ask people to basically tell them, you beep them periodically across every day for a couple of weeks, and you basically say, in this situation, how introverted is your behavior? How extroverted, how shy, things like that. And what you find when you do that is that the variability within an individual across days is just as high as the variability between individuals. And So one question is, how can this stable, this system that I just talked about that produces stable between individual differences, also produce such high within individual variability? And my initial response was pretty easily. So, but I'm not sure other people agree. But anyway, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to show how this kind of system can actually give you sort of the same kind of system can give you these kinds of variability over time. So as everybody knows, you know, our behavior is really highly dynamic, and it does vary considerably over time. We all know that. We go to parties and act one way. We go to the library to study. We act very differently. We talk to our parents. We talk to our friends. We talk to our lovers. We behave differently in these different situations. And in order to understand this variability, we want to argue that a major source of behavioral dynamics is changes in what we want to do over time or situations. And that motivation changes in the short term due to differences in opportunities. So we look at situations and say, well, what can I do? Not consciously, but we look at situations and say, what can I do here? What can I achieve here? But the other thing that's important is our current bodily state. And as a result of those two things, and actually other factors I'm going to talk about, our behavior is going to vary considerably over time. Now, for anybody who's familiar with it, there is actually a tradition in personality psychology that goes back to a personality psychologist, Atkinson, and it's also been picked up by a guy named Bill Revell, who's at Northwestern, that have tried to model dynamics of action, and some of what they're doing is similar to what we're doing. So now, particularly to think about this the dynamics over time, we're sort of trying to pull apart a couple of different issues. One is, what's a situation? What are the important characteristics of situations? And we've long argued, actually before we started doing this modeling work, that one really useful way to think about situations is that situations tell us what kinds of motives or goals we can try to pursue in those situations. And that's a really important part of our knowledge of situations. And when I say knowledge, I don't necessarily mean conscious. But it's something we know about situations. And, you know, quite obviously, different situations afford the pursuit of different goals. When we're sitting in a classroom like this listening to a lecture, there are different goals that are sort of active and that are obvious than if we're sitting at a coffee shop with our partner, okay? So they provide very different affordances, to use J.J. Gibson's term. And as a result of the affordance being different, the behaviors will vary. But the other thing that's important is our interoceptive or bodily state. So, for example, recently Kent Berridge and earlier Antoine Bechara and other folks have argued that one of the things that plays a really important role in motivated behavior is our current bodily state. Information about how hungry are we, thirsty, lonely, things like that. But people like Kent Berridge have argued that you can't just consider sort of the affordances and the interceptive state separately. That in fact, the better way to think about them, or the more accurate way to think about them, is that situation, if you're interested in understanding motivation, that the situation is multiplied by the interceptive or bodily state that's relevant to that cue. And that gives you the sense of wanting. So the idea is that wanting social interaction is not simply a function of how attractive other people are. It's also a function of how lonely you are. Or conversely, how lonely you are isn't going to predict whether you approach a group of people necessarily. It's also going to be how attractive those people are. So the idea of wanting sort of encapsulates two separate sources of variability of the strength of the cue or the affordance and the interceptive state. And the further idea is that there is some sort of a multiplicative relationship so that each factor can play at least a partial gating role in controlling behavior. So you may have attractive food, but you're not hungry, interesting people, but you're not lonely. Another source of variability in behavior beyond the impact of the situation and the affordances I mean the situation and the interoceptive state, is the idea that motivation is competitive. So the likelihood of behavior isn't the strength of wanting one thing in isolation, it's how much you want that thing compared to how much you want other things. So obviously, if we're moderately hungry with food around, but we're also very thirsty, we'll probably drink. If there's no water around, we'll eat the sandwich. Okay. So in the following simple simulations, I'm going to examine the impact of each of these factors on variability. I'm going to look at the role of affordances, current interceptive state, and competition. And the network here, it's sort of a simple version of the virtual personalities model that we use to sort of represent a college student. Although, as I told my lab team the other day, we forgot to put sex in here. But you sort of, you know, so here's the environmental features: friend, library, food, social situation, danger. Here's your interoceptive state: need for affiliation, achievement, hunger, social anxiety, fear. Here's different motives: affiliation, achievement, hunger, rejection, and harm. So you have the input from the environment and the interoceptive state that sends activation to the approach and the avoid layers, where these two things are multiplicatively combined, and then activation then goes to the behavior layer. And then actually the other thing that happens, which is another source of variability, is we send activation to the behavior layer, and then depending upon your behavior, you get these consummatory or satiety states. So if you eat food, the food disappears. If you leave the situation, the friends disappear. If you eat food, after a while, you don't get hungry. If you hang out with your friends for after a while, you're not as lonely. So this particular simulation, what happens is you generate a behavior, and then the program says, well, what's the behavior? And then based on the behavior, it will then change either an environmental state or an interoceptive state. Another thing that happens in this model is we also do have the fact that interoceptive states, such as hunger or need for social affiliation, can actually change over time. So simply because you haven't been with people for a while, you're going to get lonelier. Or simply because you haven't eaten for a while, you're going to get hungrier. So this is the basic flow of control. You basically take cues in the environment, interoceptive state. They get multiplicatively combined to generate the wanting or motive that generates the behavior. And then based on the behavior, that can modify the environment and can modify interoceptive state. So I'm going to put up just a couple of simple simulations. This graph has a couple of different, so these are the affordances. So this is the environment. This is interoceptive state for this individual. So these are the two input layers. This is the calculated motive or activation tendency. These are the activations of the behaviors in the output layer, and the top is just what behavior is actually chosen. So as you can see, this blue is basically your friends around for a while, but then they leave. You're in the library pretty continuously. There's no food around, but all of a sudden a friend calls and says, hey, I've got some food, let's get together. And then there's a cue to danger in the environment. So these are affordances in the environment. These are your interoceptive state. You just have a high need for affiliation. But you need to study because you've got an exam. After a while, you get hungry. And then obviously, because there's a danger cue, you're going to feel anxiety. And then these are multiplicatively combined. So, you know, up here, obviously, you have the friend and a need for affiliation. So you have a strong action tendency. But your friend leaves, and that all of a sudden drops. And now you have this action tendency to study, which immediately takes over. But you still have this need to study, but then you start getting hungry, and food appears, and all of a sudden, food is, you know, eating becomes the dominant action tendency, and that drives behavior. So you can see this you know, hang out with friends, study, eat, hang out with friends, I mean, and then study again, okay? So those three sources of so there are a number of sources of variability that in that, and you're gonna see these changes over time. A couple of other small things, but, so here's an example. We just assumed a different satiation rate for hunger. So this is somebody over here who takes longer to get over being hungry. And one of the things that you see, so this is the previous figure, and this person, so their interoceptive state starts to go down and they get to the point where the action tendency for eating is lower than for studying. So they eat for a while, but then go back to studying. This person, their interoceptive state doesn't go down very fast, so they actually continue to eat and they never go back to studying. Okay, and then another example, a last example. So in this example, we manipulated the sensitivity of the gain layer. And this actually also shows the impact that change, that behavior can have on your environment and therefore change in behavior over time. So this is again the first figure. In this case, what happened is we didn't change anything. This is the same as the first figure in terms of the inputs, but we changed the sensitivity on to threat, to specifically to danger. And in this case, what happens is like this person, they're feeling sort of anxious because of the threat, but they never do anything. This person, the interoceptive state, because the gain is higher, gets a little bit higher. I'm sorry, the interoceptive state, I think, the interoceptive state stays the same. But the gain here is higher, so therefore, the action tendency now is higher than any of the other action tendencies. So now you actually leave the situation. But notice what happens, too, is because you've left the situation, the danger signal has now disappeared. So over here, you never left the situation, so the danger signal stays high. But here you leave the situation, the danger signal, the affordance disappears, and therefore all your interceptive and other states change as well. Okay, so this is the argument. So we're arguing that this gives you an example of how you could take the same kind of motivational structure, and now you could get very high within individual variability. So you could get very high within individual variability, but you can also, across individuals, get this very stable structure. And we've shown that how three different factors can play out in that. So the affordances, the interoceptive or bodily state, and the role of competition. So the last thing I want to do is quickly talk about some ways in which we're planning to modify the model and some ways in which we're thinking about how the pieces of this model map on to what we know about the neuroscience or neurobiology of reward and punishment systems or sort of incentive systems. So this is what we're thinking of about a modified version of the model. And one of the things we're now doing, the previous version of the model, there were no seeking behaviors, so you could either If food was there, you could eat it, but there was never a situation in which you would actually go looking for behavior, go looking for food. So we're now going to add a situation in a version of the model in which interoceptive state can directly drive seeking behavior. So if you're really, really hungry, it can now lead you to go look for food. Or you're really lonely, you can now look for other people. We also have this pathway where environmental features can end up driving behavior directly. And so basically what you have here is you now have the interoceptive state can directly affect seeking, and now you have environmental features, maybe this pathway may correspond to something like habit formation. So you would now have environmental cues directly drive behavior without the intervening impact of motivation. One of the other things we've been thinking about and reading about is there's obviously a tremendous amount of work which suggests that the orbital frontal cortex and the ventromedial prefrontal cortex play a critical role in representing value, but also the identity of rewards and punishments. So they don't just represent values, but they also represent, particularly the orbital frontal cortex, represents a lot of information about the, is this a, you know, the characteristics of a food reward versus a social reward. And so we would like to sort of model that. And then we're also, and so in terms of how this maps onto sort of a, you know, sort of neural systems, we're arguing based on work by Bashara and other people that the insula and maybe other systems are going to represent bodily state, at least in terms of the wanting system, that this is just various sensory systems that are going to give you information about the environment. That this motivational system, you might think of as sort of a motivational incentive salience system, and there's a lot of work that suggests that there's a system that consists of the amygdala, the ventral striatum or nucleus accumbens, the ventral pallidum, and the caudate. And then one of the things we have started to get very interested in is there's a tremendous amount of work, more with animals and not as much with humans, on the role of various kinds of learning, such as Pavlovian learning and instrumental learning in behavior. So we're sort of speculating that to some extent you might be able to think of this pathway from environmental cues through this representation to the motivation as being akin to sort of Pavlovian learning, and then the association between, say, the representation of wanting and behavior as akin to sort of a bidirectional instrumental learning system. And then one of the things we're starting to explore, but haven't really done much with, is trying to apply the whole idea of what's called Pavlovian instrumental transfer. And that for those who aren't familiar, Pavlovian instrumental transfer is the idea that's pretty, it's also called classical conditioning. But the idea would be that, you know, you learn that a cue predicts the availability of a particular value. So a lot of times, like with rat studies, you'll show rats like these figures, and they learn to associate, or not figures, but say a light or a sound, and the light predicts food and the sound predicts water. And then separately, you train them in an instrumental conditioning task in which one lever gives you food and the other lever gives you water. And then later, if you present the Pavlovian cue, it's going to increase the likelihood that you're going to do the instrumental response that is associated with the Pavlovian cue. So if you have to choose between food and water, if the Pavlovian cue, like the light, was earlier associated with food, you're more likely to press the food lever. If, on the other hand, you know, if I give you the sound and that was associated with water, you're more likely to press the water lever. Which I'm increasingly beginning to think is a good model for human behavior. You walk into social situations, you recognize the cues to particular rewards, and that potentiates particular behaviors in that situation. So just future directions and to wrap up, we're currently working on this project with a group from the University of Colorado Boulder, Seth Hurd, Randy O'Reilly, and a group of other folks, under a grant that's funded by National Institute of General Medical Sciences to develop sort of a general neural network model of decision making and motivated behavior. And ultimately, we would like to, you know, the model I showed you today is pretty much a model of sort of motivated behavior. It doesn't include things like self-regulation and higher level self-control. So. And ultimately, as I said, this started as a personality model, but it's turning more into a model of motivated decision making. Thank you very much.